Hey folks, and welcome to another episode of Crit Hit Reviews with your host, Arlian. On today's episode, I'll be talking about the review copy I received of Troglobyte Games' neon-flavored roguelite, Hyper Parasite. But did I take to this tentacle-ridden title, or was this a parasite I passed? The year is 1980X. A new threat emerges from the unknown depths of space. One which makes even the ever-present threat of the Cold War pale in comparison. Its name? The Hyper Parasite. A malign body snatcher who has set its sights on POTUS Ray Gunn in the hopes of setting off a nuclear war that all but ensures
complete global saturation.
The introductory movie aside, you won't actually have much of a narrative to fuss over, given the crux of your journey will play out like a slaycation across various different regions. You can speak to the mildly uncanny shopkeeper who's given a bit of personality, and also helps to hint at secrets in the area, but other than that, you'll just need to wait until the very end of the game to see any sort of story resolution. I will say though that when I finally did come to the game's climax, I found myself genuinely pleased as it provided a pretty solid outro to the entire experience. That and a few good laughs to boot. Still, getting to the end did take a while. See, Hyper Parasite is a solidly challenging roguelite that provides players with a mix of twin-stick shooter and brawler mechanics. And that's because the titular parasite's possession ability is a key mechanic of the game, which enables you to possess almost every single character you encounter and then wield their abilities against their former allies. Well, provided you can fulfill a few stipulations. Sure, the game is kind enough to provide you a few basic bodies to swap between when you first begin the game, but you're otherwise unable to acquire new hosts until you tear out their brain and bring it over the shopkeeper in a given region. Conceptually, it's a pretty neat idea to be fair, but in execution, I found it rather tedious in the long run for a wide variety of reasons. First is that it incorporates a fair amount of RNG into the game, as the brains needed to unlock hosts are dropped from elite versions of the enemies, who, as an aside, can basically just one-shot you frequently, as well as three mini-bosses in each area, which ends up feeling increasingly like a gamble as you progress further in the game, as the odds of finding an elite character you haven't unlocked gradually narrow, and it takes progressively more time to reach the later zones and pray you encounter a mini-boss you haven't met yet. This is then further compounded by the sheer grinding that's layered on top of this, as merely acquiring the brain isn't enough. You need to invest a scaling amount of cash to activate the ability to possess that host, enough so that it winds up becoming prohibitively expensive as you reach the later areas of the game. And considering that there's a good portion of the game gated behind the abilities of specific hosts you encounter, or hidden until you acquire a specific number of potential hosts in a region, we're talking entire areas replete with new enemies to encounter and unlock, barred off until RNG just smiles upon you. But if you're still searching for a reason to evoke feelsbadman.jpg, you need to look no further than the first new area you arrive at, given that you'll find yourself immersed in a drastically scaled up plethora of mooks, none of which you can possess.
No, God!
That's right, each new area you arrive at provides both a substantial jump in difficulty and is completely bereft of any default bodies, which can make things just feel like a slog, which is probably a big part of why I went to such ends to unlock the mini-bosses as possible hosts, since they represent major upgrades to your capabilities. That's not to say you can't fight as the parasite, but let's lay out a small comparison here. The host bodies each have a unique skill set, can acquire things like elemental attack modifiers and defenses, and even have modifiers to all your stats which scale up with the quality of the host bodies you progress through the game, and these serve to multiply the gains you get from permanent power-up titles you encounter over the course of a run. The parasite, on the other hand, is so fragile there's a dedicated upgrade spot to ensure his minute, mucusy bod can take a single extra hit. That's right, you can choose one of the limited power-up tiles in a run and forgo the option of getting stronger for your attack or defense for any and all host bodies you encounter in that run to take a single extra hit because he dies in one by default. And given that the defense upgrades fully heal your host bodies, it feels like such a tremendous waste and a giant reminder about just how pathetic the parasite's basic bitch bod is. Oh hey, and for other reasons why the parasite's base form is pathetic mess, your host bodies also have a means of leveling up independently of power-up tiles. See, if you're good at diligently destroying your foes in a fast and furious fashion, look at a combo announcement. These let you know that the skull on the portrait of your character's filled in, and they've gained a permanent attack multiplier. The better combos you've managed, the more skulls fill in, and these last until you vacate your host, a system that's not available for the parasite itself. Heck, even the majority of the passive skills that you encounter will by and large empower your host body and not the parasite. Honestly though, I think the main reason I'm irritated by all the gating and elements I talked about earlier isn't just because of how puny the parasite is itself. Nope! I think what galled me is the fact that there's some rather nasty crash bugs in Hyper Parasite that had triggered repeatedly when I tried to acquire new brains. And just once from a facehugger attack, all of these were in the same area. But the thing that made it just so offensive to me was the fact that the game flushes all the progress you've made during that run down the drain if you crash. And given I find myself needing to save up money from the very start of the game and drag it with me through multiple regions in an effort to make even a dent in the cost of later host bodies, which you can only try and purchase while you're in that region, yeah. I actually wound up hurting my hand from punching the desk repeatedly out of frustration. And yet, it did this to me consecutively in Act 4, including a couple times on stream. Like, motherfucker! So, anyways, they eventually came out with a new game mode called Rome Millennium, which grants the player just a whole lot more control. Right off the bat, every single character is able to be possessed, no fuss, no muss. What's more, you can actually pick to start as any of the characters in the game, including one of the final mini-bosses, which is, pretty friggin' powerful. I mean, there is actually a chance for you to start as any of the characters you've unlocked maybe if you start a new game, but this just lets you pick anyone in the game, period. The game also just outright provides you access to every single key item you'd normally need to solve puzzles to find, allowing you to effectively access all of the game's optional areas off the hop. Honestly, it's likely the major reason why I ultimately ended up seeing the end of the game, as I would have otherwise found myself engaged in a very protracted loop of venture forth, hope to reach a shop and find a brain in Act 5, die miserably, rinse repeat. That said, there's also a score attack mode to engage in if you do want something that's a much more shorter and less frustrating experience. It does serve as a decent bit of practice for mastering the game, especially given that getting the highest score requires you to tear through levels at breakneck speeds without possessing anything. All of this frustrating elements aside though, one thing I do have an immense amount of praise for is the game's sound design. Hyper Parasite's soundtrack is fantastic through and through. I was extraordinarily happy to meet with a plethora of new jams to listen to with each new segment of the game. Moreover, the voice work is delightfully hammy.
Let us show him what we're made of. Thank you. God bless you.
The other things that did manage to get on my nerves were the audio bug that loops weapon sounds and the voice work, air quote, during the outro that managed to elicit winces from me. It didn't detract too much from the end, but it gets old quick. Despite those small hiccups, I am still altogether enamored with the game's aesthetics, and I do have to acknowledge its graphics are on point. There's a broad array of enemies to encounter and possess, and I really like both their models and the effort put into their character portraits. There's also a lot of neat touches, and this is easily seen during both the intro and outro movies. At the end of the day, however, I still find myself quite hung up on how it plays. At a fundamental level, I do enjoy a lot of what Hyper Parasite has to offer. I really dug how the random generation helped keep the runs fresh, and there's a genuinely solid amount of enemies and obstacles for each area, and the unique ones cropping up in the secret subzones, and the whole process of discovering those was interesting. That said, as much as those elements helped to entice me, I still found my initial enthusiasm turning to a sort of burnt-out weariness as I played. Game crash-inducing bugs and loss of progress are galling, especially when you invest something like an hour and a half of your time or more. But it hurts to such a substantial degree when it serves to compound the issue of the game's progression gating. Needing to invest that time so you can even have a chance of unlocking a character you're missing, and then losing the ability to make progress on unlocking them until you loop around again another and a half. It's something. Which, I mean, I can definitely say, for that alone, I did appreciate the Rome Millennium mode. Oh, and whilst I haven't touched on it, there is a co-op for this game. I never actually got the opportunity to dive into this with anyone, and ultimately found myself not really wanting to once I'd cleared it, in part to just how frustrating a portion of my time with it was. Which is why I'd ultimately rate this game as a fumble. There were times I really liked this game. There were times where I struggled with it immensely. I think the fact that I need to go out of my way to bypass segments of the game to avoid crashes is definitely problematic. But it does have a charm to it, and I can certainly see how there's enough content to appeal to folks. Hell, it had me hooked for a while until I hit the later portions and found whatever joy the game once held ground out of my soul. Anywho, thanks for tuning in! If you agree, disagree, or just have something to say to me, feel free to comment. And for those interested in more indie reviews, developer interviews, podcasts, or Monday TTRPG content that I swear will return one day probably, hit the subscribe button and the bell so you know when there's a new release. There's also a Discord, you can click the link in the banner or description so you can be part of our community, the Critic Cauldron. Lastly, if you'd like to help support the channel, we do have a Ko-fi running now to help supplement funds for our lovely editor and make sure we can continue to provide quality content. Again, check the description of the banner for them links. That said, I'll catch you on the next episode of Crit Hit, folks. Take care till then.